Welcome to my classroom. In this chemical process calculation course, we are discussing about energy balance in unit operations. Energy balance in unit operations. We have already seen 2-3 lectures on energy balance in evaporators. We have seen energy balance in crystallizers, how to do numericals, what is the energy balance equation, right? In addition to material balance, we have to do energy balance and how to determine the heat transfer area required, all that we have done, right? So now in this module, we are going to discuss about another important unit operation, which is very old unit operation, because chemical engineering professionally from 8th century onwards, we have been separating out the chemicals using this unit operation. Okay, distillation is one of the important unit operations from very long time, right? The before 20 BC itself, people used to separate out ethanol for medicinal purposes, and scent fragrances have been distilled out from the plants, all this thing. Okay, so that way this distillation is a very old process, but chemical engineers widely use it in chemical industries because it has become a very energy intensive unit, which is very, it doesn't need any third component to separate the things. Okay, so distillation is essentially a unit operation wherein by supplying heat to the system, by vaporizing a liquid mixture, we can separate them into its constituents. For example, if you are having a binary mixture of A and B, where A is more volatile component, B is less volatile component. When I say more volatile component, its boiling point is less. Less volatile component means its boiling point is high. So when you have a binary mixture containing more volatile component A and less volatile component B, they have their difference in boiling point is more than 10 or 20 degrees Celsius. We are sure that they have different boiling point. In that case, what we can do is, we can heat the liquid mixture to one of temperature slightly higher than the temperature of the more volatile component. That is, for example, I have a component A which is boiling point is 100. I have another component which has boiling point 200. So when I have this mixture, so it is easy for me to heat this liquid mixture to 120 degrees Celsius, where I know that this A will be vaporized, B will not be vaporized, but A may carry some of the B along with it. Okay, so that way in a distillation column, by supplying heat to the system by basis of the principle of difference in vapor pressure, so what we do is the component which is more volatile will get boiled, and so we are going to get an overhead product which will be rich in more volatile component. Okay, the top product or overhead product, which is called as distillate, will be rich in more volatile component A, and it may contain small amount of less volatile component B, and we are going to get a bottom product, where bottom product is going to be rich in less volatile component B, because most of the A have reached the top of the column, means it has escaped through the top of the column because it was vaporized. So this bottom product, which is a liquid essentially, will be rich in less volatile component B, and it may contain some amount of A. So the compositions, remember the feed also having both A and B in distillation, that is the difference between other crystallization and evaporation. Because in evaporation, the water evaporator will not contain any solute in it. Okay. In case of crystallizer, the crystal formed will be pure crystal. It won't contain any solvent in it. Right. But in case of distillation, all three components will have all the components. For example, feed is having 5 components. You are going to get an overhead product where also these all the 5 may be there. The bottom product where you may have all the 5. Okay, there may be some cases it may be negligible, but it will essentially contain all the components. So that way, when we have a feed, the difference in the vapor pressure can be defined with one of the term called as relative volatility. Relative volatility is a measure of separability of a liquid mixture into its constituents. Let me say we can simply define this relative volatility as, we know the we are going to have a vapor liquid equilibrium. We have vapor and liquid coming in equilibrium in this because it is essentially a mass transfer phenomena taking place, right? So we have a mass transfer between vapor phase and the liquid phase. The solute molecules or the solvent molecules are moving across this thing. Okay, this is an example for even equimolar counter diffusion. A is going into B, or we can say B is coming into A. Okay, liquid going into vapor coming into liquid. relative volatility is the ratio of mole ratios of more volatile component to less volatile component in the vapor phase to that in the liquid phase. For example, in vapor also you are going to have A and B, it will have certain mole fractions, right? If you take the mole ratios of A to B in the vapor phase, and similarly you take the ratio of mole ratios of A and B in the liquid phase, if you make a ratio between these two, what we get is relative volatility, and it should be greater than 1 for distillation to be effective. So always alpha should be, we can denote this relative volatility by alpha. So this alpha should be always greater than 1. Higher the R means higher the is alpha, you are going to have better separation, because depending upon alpha value, so we are going to plot equilibrium curve x versus y and a diagonal line which is 45 degree line. So the if alpha value is more, we are going to have this equilibrium curve far away from the diagonal line, which means ease of separation is more. That's it. So it is an indicator. The alpha is an indicator of this ease of separability in using distillation, right? So this your equilibrium curve is far away from this diagonal line, so the separation is going to be easy. Therefore, the number of steps or number of plates required, the height of the tower going to be less. Whereas your when alpha is very less, close to 1, so what is going to happen? So your equilibrium curve and diagonal line are very close to each other. That way the driving force is less. The driving force for mass transfer to take place is going to be less, and hence the number of stages required is going to be more. That means the height of the tower, height of the column, packed column or the plate columns is going to be more. So that way, so we show this, if alpha is greater than 1, this distillation can be applicable. Okay, so that way alpha is defined as YA by YB divided by XA by XB, where YA, YB are mole fractions of more volatile component A and more volatile component B in gas phase. Similarly, XA and XB are mole fraction of more volatile component A and less volatile component B in liquid phase. Okay, so remember we are talking about this vapor and liquid equilibrium conditions in the distillation column. Okay, so that way we have this distillation column. This distillation column is widely used. As I said, it has been used to produce ethanol, make fragrances, right? So all that. But recently widely after this 8th century, it has been widely used to alchemists have started using this distillation operation for separating out pure components from chemical substances. To separate out the chemical substances, officially it has been used for used in the production, bulk production, in industrial production, and this distillation is used as a separation operation. Okay, so that way this distillation is very useful. So mainly we know that once we started separating, or earlier they used to separate only kerosene out of the crude. Nowadays from crude we are separating out various products, petroleum products like petrol, diesel, natural gas, we get bottom product tar, right? And the jet fuels, all that we are getting out. So at a different column, we are going to collect different products in distillation column. So for our simple case, we are going to consider simple distillation, because some of the advantages of the distillation are distillation column does not need a third component. Okay, for example, if you consider absorption, if you consider other operations, we will be supplying solvent to the system. A third component is added to a mixture to affect the separation. But whereas distillation does not need any third component, thereby your cost of supplying other chemicals is drastically reduced. However, it is an energy intensive process, because when this unit operation is based on supplying heat to vaporize one of the more volatile components, right? So that way we have to supply a lot of heat, but it is advantageous when we have energy available within the process, because the heat available from the other units can be utilized to heat the feed into the in the distillation column. Okay, that way this energy distillation column has some advantages as well as disadvantages. The disadvantage is it is a highly energy intensive process, but if you have energy available from renewable sources or it is cheaply available, then distillation is the best method to separate the components when their boiling point difference is more than 20 degree Celsius minimum, 20 to 50 degree Celsius. Okay, that is alpha should be greater than 1 for distillation to be applied.
And if you look at the flow chart of, we have already solved numericals for material balance in distillation column. We had one input, two outputs, where F is feed, D top product is distillate, bottom product is B. Okay, so you can even call residue. So feed is equal to distillate plus residue, or feed equal to top product plus bottom product. So we had F equal to D plus B, or F equal to D plus W, whatever. So we have seen that mole fraction of A in solute, mole fraction of more volatile component XA in feed is XA XF, let in distillate let it be XD, let the mole fraction of more volatile component in the bottom product is XW or XB. So we can write in an individual material balance, overall material balance is going to F equal to D plus B, B for bottom product or W for residue, whatever. So F equal to D plus B means, what is the individual material balance for the more volatile component? It is XF into F is equal to XD into D plus XB into B, where B refers to bottom product. You can use W also. Okay. So this is the overall material balance and the individual material balance. Okay. And for energy balance, what we have to consider in addition to how many energy input are there, how many energy output are there is important to understand. Please listen carefully. So in a distillation column, the top product, actually vapor is leaving the column, but what we are collecting is distillate, which is in liquid form. What happens in between? We should have a condenser, total condenser or partial condenser. Let us consider now total condenser. What is vapor is leaving the top of the column. So the vapor needs to be condensed into liquid. That means heat to be supplied or heat to be rejected? Yes, heat is to be rejected in the condenser. So through the condenser, volume vapor has to become liquid means, condensate means, heat has to be rejected. So how much heat is to be rejected? It depends upon what is the enthalpy associated with the vapor that is entering the condenser. The same amount of vapor is leaving the thing, but in liquid form. So V, flow rate in terms of V, if condensate is C, C is equal to V, because both are same kg per hour. Okay, C equal to V. So V is entering and V is leaving. V kg per hour is entering, V kg per hour is leaving. But it is in vapor state and outlet is in liquid phase. So that way the phase change is taking place. So we can say enthalpy associated with the vapor is capital HV. Enthalpy associated with the condensate is small hv. Even though C equal to V, we are writing small h into C, h into V only, right? So that way this difference is, what is the heat to be removed? It is V kg per hour multiplied by V kg per hour multiplied by capital HV minus V multiplied by small hv. Okay, V multiplied by capital HV minus V multiplied by small HV gives us the heat to be removed in the condenser. Okay, so V is common. Once V is taken common outside, then we have capital HV minus small HV, which is nothing but lambda V. We can say capital V multiplied by lambda V is the amount of heat to be removed from the condenser. This is the first step in energy balance. And what about the overall, then next step is, in the top, this is what happening, a condenser is removing the heat. But in bottom, what is happening, you know, within the distillation column, we are not supplying heat. In the bottom, what we do is, the bottom product, which is in liquid form, is taken out, which is pumped out, and a portion is withdrawn as the bottom product. We are removing it as bottom product, which is B or W, and this liquid is to be vaporized, the heat is to be supplied to the system through a reboiler. It's like a reboiler, the liquid is vaporized and that vapor is sent back to the bottom of the distillation column. Okay, so what we are essentially doing here, we are supplying heat into the reboiler. So here we have how many energy inputs are there for a distillation column, the energy associated with the feed and heat to be supplied to the reboiler. These two are heat inputs. Okay, or we can say energy inputs. So what are the energy outputs? There are two product streams leaving. One is distillate, another one is bottom product. Overhead product and bottom product are leaving the system. So the enthalpy associated with it. So we have input, total energy inputs are enthalpy of feed plus heat to be supplied to the reboiler. These two are energy inputs. And what are the energy outputs? There are three energy outputs. One is enthalpy of the overhead product or enthalpy of the distillate. Number two, enthalpy of the bottom product or residue, and one more is what? That is heat to be removed from the condenser. So there are three, heat removed from the condenser is energy output. So we are going to solve some numericals on energy balance in distillation. Okay, take down this problem. A vapor at 411 Kelvin, it is given that a vapor at 411 Kelvin and atmospheric pressure 400 Kelvin and atmospheric pressure is containing 0.72 mole fraction of benzene and 0.28 mole fraction of toluene serves as a feed. Remember, your feed is entering as in vapor phase. Okay, so we have to simply use capital HF, that's the difference. It serves as a feed to a fractionating column. Fractionating column is nothing but a simple distillation column. A fractionating column in which it is separated into a distillate containing 0.995 mole fraction of benzene and brought on product with 0.97 mole fraction of toluene. So remember, usually always more volatile component rich one is distillate, that's why that mole fraction will be given. Whereas bottom product which is rich, that is used, that we used to specify. That's why bottom product is rich in less volatile component, which is B. If you are considering A and B as more volatile component and B volatile component, less volatile component respectively, then overhead product or distillate will be rich in A. The bottom product or residue will be rich in B. That's why B will be given mostly, but there we try, tend to make mistake, assume it to be directly XA in B. No, it is not XA in B. Mostly it will be given XB in B. That is mole fraction, mass fraction of less volatile component in the bottom product will be given in terms of less volatile component. That's why we should this give XB will be given. So we have to convert to XA. Okay, so that please take care. This 0.97 is mole fraction of toluene. Okay, the reflux ratio is decided to be 1.95 kilomoles per kilomole of distillation product. It is mentioned 1.95 kilomoles per kilomole of distillation product. That is D value per mole of D. We have to have a reflux ratio of 1.95 moles. Okay, for a feed of 100 kilomole, calculate the quantity of top and bottom product for a feed of 100 kilomole. That means basis is given. We have to take a basis of 100 kilomoles and we have to calculate first material balance. Through material balance, we are going to get what is the top product and bottom product amount, right? So that is kg kilomole, right? So we are going to get distillate in kilomoles and bottom product in kilomole in the first step. And then the condenser and reboiler heat duty, that is heat to be removed from the condenser and heat to be added to the reboiler. These two we have to determine. For that, in this problem, enthalpy is directly given. That way we are, it is easier to solve this problem. Enthalpy of vapor is given 42,200 kilojoule per kilomole mixture. Enthalpy of liquid overhead is given as 11,433 kilojoule per kilomole mixture. Enthalpy of the bottom product is given, so that is not overhead. Just copy paste it. So to edit it, it is enthalpy of bottom product which is given as 18,467 kilojoule per kilomole mixture. Enthalpy of the feed is, so enthalpy of the feed is 44,567 kilojoule per kilomole mixture. So the mostly data are directly given because this is the first problem that we are solving in energy balance in distillation column. So please try proceed to solve this problem. So let us keep the problem here. So basis, you can start with basis. So what is the value given? So let us make a flow block diagram. I have always told you that we have to start with writing a material balance and basis, right? So what is the basis? It is given here itself. It is given 100 kilomoles. Let me say basis is F equal to 100 kilomoles. Okay. F value is given. Reflux ratio is given 1.95. Why we are using B for bottom product or residue is your reflux ratio is defined. Okay. Reflux ratio is given to be 1.95. and what else is given. We'll draw the diagram so that you can mention all the points given. Okay, so first draw a distillation column. Okay, we have a distillation column. So we are going to have overhead product or distillate. So we'll have a feed. F is given, 100 moles. And the mole fraction is also given, right? XA in feed, how much? 72%. That is 0.72. That is how much is B in the feed is equal to 0.28. This I am just writing so that everywhere we should write, because in distillation column, the all stream will contain all the components A and B. So in XA, it is given like 0.995, right? XA is given 0.995. It's almost pure, right? 99.5%. XB is equal to 0.005, that is less than 1% is B. Okay, so this is the bottom product. So what we have is V, and we have L returned back to the system, and we have V equal to L plus D, and R is known. V equal to, we have R equal to L by D, therefore L equal to R into D. We have RD plus D, which is D into R plus 1. Okay, so this can be utilized here because R value is given, we can make use of it. Okay, so this is the linear balance of done. This block diagram is not completed. So from the bottom, what we have is, as I said, we have heat to be removed from the condenser, and we have heat to be added to the reboiler. Okay, residue or bottom product. So how much is bottom product? Let it be B kg for B moles. We are writing everything in moles. So we are going to have material balance in terms of moles. Okay, so we have residue. So let X A in B is this, XB in B is given. What is that? XB in B is given as 0.97. So we can subtract to get, we know summation of mole fractions is equal to 1, right? So that way 1 minus 0.97 is 0.03. Okay, so these are the data we have, and A is benzene. What is A and B? We have to mention because we have defined A and B. A is benzene and B is toluene. Remember, why, which is A and which is B? For that we should know which, based on the C, how C is higher, higher will be the boiling point. Say for example, C methane is there, C3H8 is there. If more is the amount, more higher content, higher will be the molecular weight, right? So higher will be the boiling point. Okay, so that way we know that benzene, toluene, benzene is having a boiling point of around 80 degrees Celsius. So that way it is more volatile component. Always more volatile component is to be taken as A, and less volatile component has to be taken as B. Because sometimes this will be mentioned as first and this is mentioned as second. So we should not get confused that way. That's why it is very important. We carefully choose what is our more volatile component. Say for example, for benzene it is 80 degrees Celsius is the boiling point. For toluene it is around 111. So you can say exactly 110.6 degrees Celsius. So what is our less more volatile component here? Benzene. And also from the data, which is rich in the top product, that will be your more volatile component. Okay, so from that also we can identify it if you have any difficulty in finding out which is the more volatile component. Okay, so having Return the given data, we can proceed to write the first step is write the material balance. So what is the overall material balance? You have F equal to distillate plus bottom product B. Okay. And we have F is given, right? 100 moles. F equal to 100 moles. So F equal to 100 moles. Therefore, you can write D plus B. Or you can express one of them as B equal to 100 minus D can be written, right? Because it is 1A, because it's just so after substituting, it is another form of equation 1. Okay, so then I already wrote equal to V equal to D into R plus 1. R is given 1.95, right? So R is given 1.95. So we can write all this R for comfort. Let me write D is equal to this because I will first find B. So you can do anything. D equal to 100 minus B or B equal to 100 minus D. That one you will find first. That is the difference. Okay. So if this is known, now what is the individual material balance? Individual material balance, have you written earlier? No. So we can write individual material balance, which is XF into F is equal to XD into D, okay, plus XB into B. Remember, whatever steam heat to be removed, added, that part we should not consider now because we are only doing material balance. First, we have done overall material balance. Then we will do individual material balance for more volatile component A. So this is XAF, this is XAD, this is XAB. Okay, don't confuse it here. B is used for bottom product. Okay, D is distillate, F is feed. So substitute the values. You already written the values. 0.72 into F, that is 100. 0.72 into 100 is equal to 0.03 into B, that is bottom product, plus in distillate, how much it is? It is rich in A, that is 0.995 into D, right? So we can replace this D with 100 minus B. Or you can replace B with 100 minus D. Okay, so whatever fashion. So 0.03B plus 0.995 into 100 minus B is equal to this. So this is 72. So we have only unknown parameter is B. Please simplify to get the value of B moles. Okay, so once you get this B moles, substitute in. To get D value also, D is equal to F minus B. So we will get D moles also. Yeah, please use your calculator to get the values. So what we get is 28.49. You will write your whatever I saw, sir. Use your calculator. Don't believe in my answers. B is 28.49. Substituting this 100 minus 28.49, we will get that D value. D value is 71.5 moles. Okay, all are kilomoles because it is given feed is kilomoles, 100 kilomoles. Okay, it is mentioned in the question, it is 100 kilomoles. So it is going to be B kilomoles and D kilomoles. Okay, so that way here all are in kilomoles. Okay, so that way we get B and D also in kilomoles. Now V is equal to D into R plus 1, I repeat how we did it. R is equal to L by D, P is equal to L plus D. So here we are replacing L as RD. We get D into R plus 1. Okay. So this is important. So substituting here, 1 point, R is given as 1.95. So that is 1.95 plus 1 into 71.5 is our vapor, total vapor that is coming out of the top of the column, which is 2.95 into 71.5. 2.95 into 71.5, 210.93 I can write. Okay. See how much digits after the decimals you are considering after dot, you have a uniformity, either you have 2 or 3 or 4. Okay. V is equal to 210.93. So now once V is known, what I told you, it is easy to find out what is the heat, total condenser heat load. Total condenser heat load. That is, heat is to be added or removed, that depends. So generally we can say heat load to the condenser is, actually here what you are doing, heat is removed. Okay, heat to be removed. Heat to be removed is how much? I told you that it is V into HV minus V into small HV, that is V into lambda V. Okay, so both are given. So now refer to the question. Both these data are given. So how it is given, I'll show you. So it is given enthalpy of the overhead product. What is this? This is capital HV. Okay, this is capital HV. Enthalpy of the liquid overhead is 11,443. That is small HV. So lambda V is equal to capital HV minus small HV. So that is 42,200 minus 11,433. You will get the value of lambda V. Okay, so do it. Please perform it. So lambda V is equal to HV minus small HV subscripts. Okay, so the values are 42,200 minus 11,433. Okay, so this much kilojoules. Okay, this is lambda V. How much? You write the value. 42,2000 into 11,433. How much? It's a big number. 4824. No. You multiply it, that's it. 42,200. Minus 11,433 is equal to 3767. Okay, so this is your lambda V kilojoules. Okay, per kilomole it is given, right? Kilomole of mixture. So what is your V? V is equal to, so this, what is V into total? This is equal to V into lambda, right? So substitute this into that. So what we get is total heat condenser load. So I can write here, this is equal to V into, so when you multiply this by V value, which is 210 kilomoles, right? So we have V value is equal to 210 kilomoles, and we have lambda value equal to this much. So we can get the condenser heat load. Okay. Enthalpy of condenser, I can simply say. Enthalpy of condenser is equal to lambda V into V. Okay, 30767 kilojoules per kilomole multiplied by 210.93 kilomoles. So we get this much kilojoules. Okay, so what is the value? Six eight three. There may be changes in these digits. Okay, so we will get around 65,000. Not thousand. 65 lakhs kilojoules. Okay, let it be one value. Don't you see a component? Okay. Now what we have to do? We have to use this energy balance that we have seen. What is our energy balance? Heat load to the reboiler is equal to this, right? So we should know this. So substituting the values, we will get that thing. So for that, what we can do is we can separately find out what is the enthalpy of each stream. Okay, heat load to the reboiler is equal to enthalpy of distillate plus enthalpy of bottom product plus enthalpy of condenser, which we have determined now, minus enthalpy of feed. Let us do it separately. Enthalpy of distillate is equal to, what is that? D into small hd. What is that? D value you have calculated, right? So please write that down. D value calculated is 71.5. How much? D is 71.5 kilomoles multiplied by HD value is given. Okay, refer to the question. So HD value is given. So HD value, enthalpy of the liquid overhead is your enthalpy of your overhead product. That is 11,433. Okay, so same value, 11,433 kilojoules per kilomole. So we have this getting cancelled, and this is much kilojoules. How much? Multiply and get. So you will get 11,433 into 71.5. 817,459.5 kilojoules. Okay. Similarly, complete for enthalpy of the bottom product. Enthalpy of bottom product is equal to bottom product multiplied by H into HB. Okay, so B value we have determined. So how much? Whatever is the B value, please substitute. B value is 28.49 kilomoles multiplied by, data is given, refer to the given data. It is 18467 kilojoules per kilomole of the mixture. It is given. So we have this much kilojoules. Use your calculator. 18467 into 28.49 is equal to 526124. 526124.83 kilojoules. Okay. So similarly, enthalpy of the feed can be calculated. Enthalpy of the feed is F into HF. Okay. Now F into HF is, F value is 100 given data into HF value. Please refer to the table. You have 44567 kilojoules per kilomole. So we get this much kilojoules. Use your calculator. Multiply by 100. So it is 445670 we get 44,56,700 kilojoules. Okay, so and we have already calculated heat, all the data now. So this is the enthalpy of the condenser, right? Enthalpy of the condenser we have calculated. So all the data we have now, enthalpy of distillate is there, enthalpy of bottom product is there, enthalpy of condenser is there, enthalpy of feed is there. Substituting this is this, all three to be added and enthalpy of the feed to be subtracted, you will get heat load to the reboiler. Okay, substitute and get the value. So I can keep all here, it's easy for me to write. Okay, heat load to the reboiler. Is equal to enthalpy of the distillate, which is 817,459.5 kilojoule, and enthalpy of bottom product, which is 526,124. Kilojoule. These two, and enthalpy of the condenser is 683.3. kilojoules, that is 8964. Okay, and we have to subtract this value, minus 5644 kilojoule. So this will give me heat load to the reboiler. Please do the calculation. 817,459.5 plus 526,124.83 plus 6489,683.3 minus 4456,700 is equal to 3376,567. 3376,567.63 kilojoules. Okay, so this is the heat load to the reboiler. You can say 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5 6. So you can say 3.38 into 10^6 kilojoule is the heat load to the reboiler. Okay, so that is the answer. So what we have done in this problem, I'll just explain fully again. So whatever is the given data we have written, so we have considered a distillation column where feed is 100 kilomole given data. XAF is given 0.72. We know summation of mole fractions or mass fractions is equal to 1. So we get XPF equal to 0.28. We are not using it here right now. But just to differentiate in the bottom product, data is given as 0.97. To get XA, we get used 1 minus 0.97, which is 0.03. Distillate contains 0.995A. So these data were given. And we have chosen which is more volatile component, which is less volatile component based on their boiling point. Okay, so we have written the overall material balance and the individual material balance, and we did material balance to get the value of V, D and B, and once we are done with it, we have moved on to perform the energy balance. First thing is total condenser heat load, which is V into lambda V. So V we have done calculated from material balance. Lambda V is heat of the vapor minus heat of the liquid of the top products, that is overhead product. So we got that. So once we got that, we multiplied by V to get enthalpy of the condenser, total enthalpy of the condenser. Total enthalpy of the distillate is enthalpy per mole multiplied by number of moles. So that way we get total enthalpy of the distillate, total enthalpy of the bottom product, and we have to subtract the total enthalpy of the feed to get the what is the heat load to the reboiler. So that's what we have obtained. So that is our required answer. Okay, so we'll do another next problem. So we have a given data. You go through this. A continuous operation of distillation column operating at 1 atmosphere is to be designed to separate 13620 kg per hour of a solution of benzene and toluene containing 0.4 mass fraction of benzene into an overhead product containing 0.97 mass fraction of benzene and the product bottom product containing 0.98 mass fraction of toluene. Remember, feed is given 13620, mole mass fraction is given 0.4, overhead product mass fraction is given 0.97, bottom product second less volatile component mass fraction is given 0.98. therefore our more volatile component A's mass fraction is 0.08, right? So that data we have, and reflux ratio is given 3.5. feed will be at its reflux will be returned to the column at 37.8. feed and its reflux will be at a temperature of 37.8 degrees Celsius. Enthalpy of the reflux liquid is 16 calorie per gram, which means 16 kilocalorie per gram. You should know that calorie per gram is equal to kilocalorie per kilogram. Enthalpy of the vapor having the column and the vapor, enthalpy of vapor having the column and entering the condenser, leaving the column, it is enthalpy of vapor leaving the column and entering the condenser is 129 kilocalorie per kilogram or calorie per gram. Calculate the quantity of top and bottom product, the condenser and the reboiler heat duties. Okay, so enthalpy of the liquid leaving the reboiler is given as 48.2 calories per gram, which is equal to kilocalories per kilogram. Okay, let's solve this problem. Try it yourself. This is similar to previous problem. Okay, let us solve this problem. A continuous operation of distillation column operating at 1 atmosphere is to be designed to separate 13620 kg per hour of a solution, right? So we start drawing the basis, and the basis is given. You can proceed with the problem. So we have a basis. Basis is 13620 kg per hour. 13620 kg per hour. And draw the diagram. So we are going to have L and distillate. V is the top product. We have feed. Okay. We have bottom product. And another. Okay. So these are the things. So we heat condenser, enthalpy of the reboiler. Okay, so this is our distillation column. Okay, so what are the data given? F value is given 16. F is given 13620 kg per hour, and xf is given 0.4, and xd is given 0.97. Now what is xb? XB is given point. It's X actually less volatile component is given. So we have to subtract from one to get what is the component A, XAB. Okay, to avoid confusion, I am writing with A, but A is understood. Okay. XA in bottom product. B for bottom product. Here this B represents this bottom product. Okay. So it is 0.02. So these are the data known. What we can do is we can start solving the problem. So once we have this, so what is the overall material balance? Overall material balance is F equal to B plus D. Okay, F is given 13,620 equal to B plus D. So we can write D equal to 13620 minus B. As I said, you can either take D any one in this so that you will get that value first. That's all. Okay, so we have D equal to 13620 minus B. So if you write the individual material balance, we have XF into F is equal to XB into B plus XD into D. So if you have XF value 0.4, so 0.4 into 13620 is equal to bottom product is 0.02 into B plus XD is 0.97 into D. Okay, so can we replace D in terms of B? So what you will get is 0.02 into 13620 minus B no 0.97. Okay, let's solve this. This is equal to 0.02B plus 0.97 into 13620 minus B. Okay, so what we get is solving, it is an expression with only B term involved in it. So solving, you will get B value equal to 8172 kg per hour, because F is given this much kg per hour. So all are in kg per hour. Okay, so once you have B value, you will determine the T value equal to 13620 minus 8172, this much kg per hour, right? So once you get the D value, how much you will get? 5448. Okay, 13620 minus 8172, yeah, 5448. Okay, so once we have this value, so we know what is V value. V is equal to, remember, recall again that one, reflex ratio is L by D, but V is equal to L plus D. So substituting here, RD plus D equal to V, we have D into R plus 1, right? So substituting here, so D into R plus 1, and R value is given in this problem. How much? R value is given as 3.5, right? R is given 3.5, so that is 3.5 plus 1 into 5448 kg per hour gives me this much kg per hour. So what is our V value? So V value is 5448, already have, multiplied by 4.5 is 24516. 24516. Okay, this much kg per hour. Okay, so once we have V value, other data is given. Okay, so you can find out the condenser heat load. What is condenser heat load? Enthalpy of the condenser or condenser heat load or total condenser heat load is equal to V into HV minus V into small HV, where capital HV is vapor condensate enthalpy, right? So V into HV minus small HV. So both values are given. V value we have determined to be 24516 kg per hour, right? Multiplied by HV and small HV are given, right? Refer to the question. Both values are given as 129 and 16. Enthalpy of the vapor is entering the condenser 129, enthalpy of the reflex liquid is 16, mean that is going to be the same for top product as well as your condensate that is coming out. So 129 minus 16, okay, 129 minus 16. So what is the unit? Along with unit you write calorie per gram. That is, you can say kilocalorie per kilogram, right? So the, remember, calorie per gram, when you multiply by kk here, you get the same. That is multiplying by 1000 in the numerator denominator also going, does not make change, right? So that way directly we wrote calorie gram as kilocalorie per kg, so that we get the unit tally here. So what we get is this much kilocalorie per hour. Okay, so that is the condenser heat load. So that is 129, whatever is the answer, 24516 multiplied by bracket 129 minus 16, close the bracket, equal to 2770308. Okay, so this is your condenser heat load. So that is step one is over. So what is the step two? We are trying the energy balance, right? What is energy balance? There are two energy inputs, three energy outputs. Okay, so that is feed. Feed is entering its enthalpy. It is given it is entering as vapor. So F into HF plus heat load to the reboiler is equal to enthalpy of the distillate, right? D into HD plus B into HB plus this one. Heat load to the condenser. Okay, so this, so if you take it to the right hand side, we get heat load to the reboiler is equal to D into HD plus B into HB plus H into condenser minus H condenser minus F into HF. Okay, so substitute the values to get your answer. Please comment your answer here. So you will get kilocalorie per hour. So remember, all the values are given in calorie per gram. So that is equivalent to kilocalorie per kilogram. So please comment your answer. How much kilocalorie per hour you are getting? Okay. So how to do that? So you will calculate all the enthalpy of the feed first, right? So let us calculate enthalpy of the feed. Right? H into, sorry, F into HF. That is, feed is given 13620 into 40.8. Get this much kilocalorie per hour. All our kilocalorie per kg it becomes. Kilocalorie per hour. Okay. Similarly, what is the enthalpy of the enthalpy of product that is distillate equal to D into HD. Okay. So whatever is the value, this get. This much kilocalorie per hour. Okay, so enthalpy of bottom product is equal to B into HB. B value we know, 8172 kg per hour into 48.2 kilocalorie per kg. Okay. So enthalpy of the product also you check. Enthalpy of the product is, it is given 16 kilocalorie per kg. D value is 5448. Okay, so you'll get kilocalorie per hour. So once you have all these four value, substitute here to get what is the heat of the reboiler. So you are calculating this separately, this and this already. This is separate calculated earlier. So substitute to get the value of heat added to the reboiler. Okay, please comment your answer. So all the data are given directly. Sometimes reverse data can be calculated. Okay, once you all this forward calculation, what we have done, reverse calculation also can be asked. Okay. So in the previous lecture, we have done a problem on crystallizer or evaporators, and we have seen what is LMTD, right? With that, there is a gate question which I thought I will solve it in this class. So take down this problem. We have a gate question. Hot water enters, flow rate is given 0.01 meter cube per minute. Hot water enters the tube side of hot water enters the tube side of a counter current. It's given co-current. Okay, it's entering a co-current actually. Entering a co-current shell and tube heat exchanger. It's an heat exchanger just for us, because right now we are not doing cores. Let it be some heat exchanger. Co-current heat exchanger at 80 degrees Celsius and leaves at 50 degrees Celsius. Cold oil 0.05 meter cube per minute of density is given 800 kg per meter cube, and specific heat of 2 kilojoule per kg Kelvin enters at 20 degrees Celsius. The LMTD is A 32 degrees Celsius, B 45 degrees Celsius, C 37 degrees Celsius, and D 50 degrees Celsius. Okay, you have to find out delta T logarithmic mean. So it is a co-current operation. It is given hot fluid and cold fluid are entering the system. This is the length of the tube. Okay, length of the heat exchanger, let me say. So hot fluid is temperature of the hot fluid at the entrance, temperature of the hot fluid at the location 2. Okay. Similarly, cold fluid, temperature of the cold fluid here and temperature of the cold fluid here. But it is co-current direction, both are flowing in same direction. So the temperatures are given, right? One temperature is unknown. So once we find the temperature, you will find out the LMTD, right? What is the temperature here is the question. So for example, here the temperature is given like 80 degrees Celsius. Okay. So here it is leaving at 50 degrees Celsius. It is entering at 20 degrees Celsius. So these data were given. So this temperature is unknown, because if you want to find delta L logarithmic mean, we should know delta T1 minus delta T2 by ln of delta T1 by delta T2. The delta T1 is difference in this temperature. So it is 80 minus 60, right? So delta T1 is equal to 80 minus 20, which is 60 degrees Celsius. Similarly here, what is delta T? We have to, for that we don't know this temperature. Once you get this temperature, you will get what is this delta T2. Okay, delta T2 is 50 minus what is the temperature unknown. So once we get that, we can substitute here to get delta LT. So how to get this one? We have to do the energy balance. Okay, so what are the data given in this question? If you look at the question, so it is given that 0.04 is the meter cube. Okay, this volumetric flow rate is given, means again you have to make use of your fluid mechanics concept that m dot is equal to rho into q. Okay, so rho into q. So this q dot, this q is given, volumetric flow rates are given in meter cube per minute, right? Meter cube per minute into density kg per meter cube will give us flow rate in kg per minute. Okay, so this m dot can be calculated, right? MCP delta T, for that we will make use of it. Okay, so what is the data given? Q of hot fluid is given as 0.01 meter cube per minute. Okay, so what is hot fluid? It is water. So water density is 1000 kg per meter cube will give me this much kg per minute. Okay, so substitute to get 0.04 into 1000, yeah, obviously it is 2 digits, 10. Okay, so QH. Similarly, what is the flow rate of cold fluid? It is flowing at 0.05 meter cube per minute, but its density is given as 800 kg per meter cube. So flow rate of, sorry, this is not QH, this is m dot of hot fluid. M dot of cold fluid is equal to Q into rho into density of the cold fluid. Okay, which is, we get this much kg per minute. So what is the value? 800, 5% of 800. Okay, so you get around 40 kg per minute. Other than this, what are the data given? The data given are Cp of cold fluid is given as 2 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Okay. Similarly, Cp of the hot fluid is given. No. Cp of hot fluid, we should know. What is that? 4.186 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. So remember, for water, data, density, Cp value will not be given, even in thermodynamics course. Yes, so we should know Cp value of water is, hot fluid here is 4.186. okay, so what you can do, what is that temperature? So Cp value is given, Ch value is given. Okay, so what is delta T? Delta T is 80 minus 50, because that is the temperature to which it is reduced, right? Temperature is reduced from 80 to 50. So with that, we have 30 Kelvin. Okay. So what is the heat loss by the hot fluid? For hot fluid, temperature difference is 80 minus 50 degrees Celsius. Okay. 30 degrees Celsius, which is equivalent to 30 Kelvin also, because delta T means whatever is the unit difference is going to be the same. Okay, so for heat loss for the hot fluid is m dot hot fluid into Cp of hot fluid into delta T of hot fluid. Okay, so that is the heat lost by the hot fluid. Heat lost by hot fluid is mcp delta T. So you can have m, we have calculated how much you calculate, 10 kg per minute, right? So we have 10 kg per minute into 4186 joules per kg Kelvin. So remember, it is 4186 joules per kg Kelvin if you are substituting in joules per minute. Okay, 4186 joules per kg Kelvin into 30 Kelvin. So we get kg getting cancelled. So what we have is this much joules per minute. Okay. So use your calculator to get the value. 10 multiplied by 4186 into 30, 1255 800. Okay. So this much joules per minute. So we can say 1.26 megajoules per minute, and we don't want that right now. Let us use it as it is, because it's a gate question. We have to get an answer on which is close to the LMTD value given. Okay, so what we have to do, so heat lost by this, what about at steady state? We know what is the heat gained by the cold fluid. Heat gained by cold fluid at steady state, this should be equal to this, right? So at steady state, but what is the temperature difference of cold fluid? It is entering at a temperature, it gets heated, right? It enters at a lower temperature and it gets at high, leaves at high temperature, right? It is entering at 293 Kelvin, that is 20 degrees Celsius. It is given, while cold fluid is entering, this cold fluid is entering at 20 degrees. So you have 293 Kelvin and it becomes a temperature. We don't know what is the temperature. Okay, let me say TC2. So 293 to TC2. So we are going to have a temperature. Okay. So what is that MCP delta T here? M dot C into Cp of cold fluid into delta T of cold fluid, which is equal to m we have calculated, m 40 kg per minute, m is 40 kg per minute and 2 kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Before that, so here we consider joules per kg mole Kelvin, so here also we have to consider 2 k, you know, so it is 2000. 2000 joules per Kelvin, that is 80,000. Okay, so you have 80,000 here. So substitute 1255800 divided by 80,000 equal to 1.569 into 10,000 is fine. So what is the value you get? So we get around 308.7 Kelvin, so which is equal to 35.6 degrees Celsius, that is minus 273 Kelvin gives us in Celsius. So once we have this TC2, we can substitute in LMTD 35.6. So we had 35.6. So 50 minus 35.6 is 14.4. Okay, so delta T1 is 60, delta T2 is 14.4. We can find out the delta TLM. What is delta TLM? This is 60 minus 14.4 by ln of 16 by 14.4. So we get this much degree Celsius as delta TLM. So what we get is 31.96, which is almost 32 degree Celsius. So refer to the gate question here. What is asked? If there are four answers given, so out of that, our answer is close to this option. So this is our answer. Okay, so that way this simple question is only asked at gate. So if your fundamentals are strong, you'll be able to solve more problems. Okay. Okay, take down this problem. This is again a gate problem. Na2SO4 10H2O crystals are formed by cooling 100 kg of 30% weight, that is 38% aqueous solution of Na2SO4. The final concentration of solute in the solution is 10%. So initially that is 30%, finally 30%, 10%. The weight of crystals is, there are four options. A is 20, B is 32.2, C is 45.35, D is 58.65. That is weight of crystals in kgs. Okay. So this is a simple question. Sodium sulfate hydrates, hydrates of sodium sulfate are formed by cooling 100 kg of 30% aqueous solution of Na2SO4. So we have a basis, right? 100 kg of feed and XF is given 0.3, and we have XM, let M be the mother liquor, XM is given 0.1. Question is, how much is the C? We know that X equal to 1 because it is pure crystal we are assuming, right? So we can write the material balance. So we have 100 is equal to, that is we know that F equal to M plus C. So we have 100 equal to M plus C, right? So we can write one in the form of another one. So we can write F minus C, M equal to F minus C, that is 100 minus C. Let it be equation number 1. Same equation rearranged with substituting 100, right? So if you write the individual material balance, this is overall material balance. If you write individual material balance, so what is the individual material balance? To write the individual material balance, we should know XE. No, XE is not 1. What is XE? We have to determine. How we will determine XE? XE is molecular weight of molecular weight of Na2SO4 by molecular weight of crystal. So that is the primary step here. They are determining the molecular weight of the numerator and denominator is a big task here. Okay. So what is the individual material balance? I can write XF into F is equal to XM into M plus XE into C, right? Let it be equation 2. We can replace this M with XM into 100 minus C plus XE into C. So XF into F, F is 100, XF is given 0.3, and the XM is given, the final solution is 0.1. Okay, so we have 0.1, but what is XE? XE is equal to, we should know the molecular weight of Na2SO4 divided by molecular weight of Na2SO4 10H2O. That is this molecular weight plus 10 times 180 plus 180, right? So if molecular weight of Na2SO4 is X, it is X, will not confuse it. If molecular weight of this is A, then MA by MA plus 180. Okay, so first calculate the molecular weight of Na2SO4. So a molecular weight of Na2SO4 kg per kg mole, which is 142. Okay, this is 322 kg per kg mole. So you get XE value as 0.441. Okay, let it be A. So substitute A in 3, we get the answer. Substituting A in 3, you will get the answer. Okay, so substitute, what is that? 30 is equal to 10 minus 0.1 C plus 0.441 into C. Yeah, please comment your answer here. So if you calculate this much kg, and is that matching with your answer, you check. Okay, out of the four options, which option is correct? You post your answer. Option A is correct, or option B is correct, or option D is correct. Please comment here. Okay, that is our final answer. We'll stop here. Okay, in this lecture, we have seen what is distillation, what are the advantages of distillation, what are the number of inputs to a in case of material balance, how many inputs are there, how many output streams are there, and we have seen what is energy balance for a distillation column. So in addition to your material balance, what we have additionally done is we have to calculate what is the heat to be removed from the condenser and heat to be added to the reboiler. These two heat additions and heat removal is there. At the top of the column, there is heat removal. At bottom of the distillation column, there is heat addition. So these heat loads has to be determined. So that is the purpose of performing energy balance. Okay, these data are useful. So whatever energy balance or material balance, that all that we are doing, what for we are doing. As a chemical engineer in any industry, if you have to design a new column and or you want to verify the thickness or the design of the process equipments present in the units are up to the mark, or whether they are in safety standards, are they safe to operate, right? So are they having the quality and the required duty to withstand the required duty, are they having the potential or not? That has to be determined by performing this material balance and energy balance. So with the data available from material balance and energy balance in a chemical industry, we are going to make use of it to further design a new reactor or design new unit operations and unit processes, or to verify what is existing, or what are the modifications to be done to your system. All that we will come to know only if you are doing this material and energy balance, and that is the purpose of learning this energy balance in unit operations, as well as we are going to learn energy balance in reactors or energy balance involving chemical reactions, which we are going to discuss in next lecture. So in the next lecture we are going to discuss about chemical reactions and energy related to chemical reactions. So in that we are going to discuss about heat of formation. What is heat of formation? Means when you have pure elements are there, heat of formation is assigned to be zero. For example, oxygen, nitrogen, heat of formation of pure elements is zero. It's a repeated question in competitive exam. So heat of formation of pure elements is zero. Okay, then whatever is compound is formed, we are going to have heat of formation. So we are going to discuss about that in detail. What is heat of formation? If a reaction is taking place to form a compound or molecule, new molecule is formed. So in that case, we are going to have heat of reaction. What is heat of reaction? What is heat of combustion? If it is a reaction, what is heat of combustion? Okay, so what are the various factors that affect the heat of the reaction? So whether, and we are going to discuss about specific heat capacity. So whether it's effect of temperature on specific heat capacity. So that we are going to do, and we are going to do adiabatic flame temperature determination for a combustion or a process where which is taking place adiabatically. So what is adiabatic condition? Adiabatic means the process is very fast such that there is no heat loss or gain from the system. The system is isolated such that there is no net heat transfer taking place between the system and the surrounding. So in that way, if you, whatever the effect we are affecting, that should take, it's a quick process. Adiabatic process means it is a quick process. So we have to define what is adiabatic flame temperature and determination of adiabatic flame temperature. So with that, we are going to completing this course. Okay, so in the next lecture, we are going to discuss about heat of formation. Then there is some laws like Hess law. Okay, so then we are going to discuss about heat of combustion. Okay, so we have to determine and do energy balance of a chemical reactor. So we are going to do all these numericals also. Okay. And if you have solved the problems, please post your answers, comment your answers. And if you have any doubts, please contact me. Thank you for joining my classroom.